Welcome back to our intermediate financial accounting class. Over the last few segments, we've been talking about depreciation, what it is, why it's important, how to do it, and then we spent the last segment talking about impairments, which are beyond normal depreciation, adjustments down in the value of our asset because something has really changed the way we do business. As we wrapped up our discussion last time, we were talking about the differences between US GAAP and IFRS for impairments, and that segues us into one of the major differences that remain between US GAAP and IFRS, and that is the idea of revaluing assets. The idea behind this revaluation is FASB and IASB's push away from historical cost towards fair value. We want companies to record their assets at a more accurate depiction of what they're worth today, as opposed to using the old traditional values from when we originally bought them. That's what this whole idea is about. US GAAP hasn't made this change yet, but IASB has. Basically, what they're doing is they're going to allow companies to choose. You can record your property, plant, and equipment at its old historical cost, or you can start recording it at its fair value. If they use the historical cost method, then the rules stay the same as what we just discussed under US GAAP. You record the value that you originally put into the asset as its historical cost, what you capitalized, and then you depreciate the asset slowly over time as you use it. If you choose to use the fair value, however, then at the end of every period, you do an assessment of your assets and you adjust the value to whatever that current market value is, up or down. It becomes actually a large and involved process. It's a lot of fun because there's some cool journal entries, but there is a lot involved in doing this. Let's take a look at the steps. Step number one, we're going to take a look at the fair value of the asset. This is the highest possible price that you could get for selling this asset. And you compare that with its carrying value. Again, historical cost minus accumulated depreciation. We then take a look at all the other assets in the asset class or category. So for example, all of our fleet of cars altogether, all of our equipment, all of our buildings, all of our land, basically, is how you would compare. And you'd see if all of them changed value or if it was just this one asset. If it's just the one asset, typically you'll let it slide for that period. If all of them have gone up, then you write them all up. So we're looking for changes overall, not just a unique one asset change. Once you decide that you need to do a change and revalue the asset, then you make a journal entry. Typically, if the asset value has increased, you credit a revaluation surplus. The debit is either to accumulated impairment losses, accumulated depreciation, or the property, plant, and equipment account. And this really is an order that we do this in. And we'll talk more about that as we do an example. If the value of the asset has decreased, then we make an entry just like an impairment. So we show a loss and put it into accumulated impairment losses. Now, the most challenging aspect, or most fun aspect, of doing these adjustments is the way that we use this revaluation surplus account and what happens with gains and losses. See, the basic rule is you can't record a gain on these revaluations, not unless it offsets a previous loss. After we've done this revaluation, then we record depreciation expense using the new amounts. So let me just draw a quick picture here. Imagine that this is our original historical cost of this asset that we've purchased, whatever it is, make it a building. If we go above the line, so the market value goes up, then I can't record a gain. I have to record a revaluation surplus. Revaluation surplus is an other comprehensive income account. It means that the market value is increased, but not because of something I've done. I don't get to show it in income. Instead, it goes below retained earnings in my balance sheet, lumped together with other comprehensive income items, such as changes in my pension account, changes in my currency translation, etc. If the price drops, then from wherever the top was, down back to the original cost, I don't have to show a loss. I'm just going to drop the revaluation surplus. So in this range, I drop the revaluation surplus. Once I drop below here, below that original value, now in this range, however far down it goes, this portion would be recorded as a loss. Finally, let's say that it jumps in value again up to here. Well, I can now show a gain, but only to the extent that it offsets this earlier loss. So if I show a $100,000 loss, I can show up to a $100,000 gain. Once I get back up to that original value, and I've shown a $100,000 gain, which matches that loss, then the rest goes back into revaluation surplus. So you really have to think about the wave on this one, not the wave like we did with cash flow, but the wave of value and how it relates to that original historical cost. And the rule here again is that it's a revaluation, anything that goes up is a revaluation surplus unless it offsets a previous loss. Anything that goes down comes out of revaluation surplus until you don't have any revaluation surplus left, and then the rest has to go into a loss. Fun, isn't it? It is. It takes you a bit to just kind of wrap your head around this. These are IASB's rules for this revaluation. Let's take a look at an example that I think will solidify this a little bit more. So this is Car Incorporated. They own a machine for producing widgets. The machine was originally purchased for $1 million. And as of December 30th, year one, it has $200,000 of accumulated depreciation that has already been recognized. What we want to do is record the depreciation and any other adjusting entries necessary if the market value is now $880,000. Now, at this point, we think the machine's got 8 years of useful life, including this year, and no salvage values. So if we're doing this the old historical cost way, we would take the $1 million minus 200,000 and divide by 8, and we end up with $100,000 of depreciation expense. And that would be it, depreciation expense, accumulated depreciation. But let's assume instead that Carr has decided to use this fair value method. If we're going to use this new method, then we need to start with a bunch of T accounts. And here they are. And you can see I put some of this information in here for us. You've got PP&E of $1 million. You've got accumulated depreciation of $200,000, and I've created the two other accounts that are necessary, at least from a balance sheet point of view, to record PP&E under the revaluation method. Once I've got my T accounts, and by the way, if you want to build these T accounts on your own so you've got them, you want to make accumulated depreciation probably a little bigger than you see here. We're going to do quite a bit in that particular account. All right, step number one. We're going to compare the fair value or market value with the carrying value of this asset or book value. So the book value will be the historical cost, that's $1 million, minus the accumulated depreciation, that's $200,000. So my book value is $800,000. Now that I got my book value, I'm going to take the market value or fair value, which we were told was $880,000, and subtract the book value. So we have an increase. Our value has gone up from what we think it's worth to what it really could sell for on the market. Since it goes up, we have to decide, have we recorded any other losses? And no, this is a brand new asset or a brand new problem, so we don't have any old losses, which means that I have to record that $80,000 in revaluation surplus. I can't show a gain. Remember, you can only show a gain if it offsets a loss. So let's take a look at our journal entry then. So on 12/31 of year one, we're going to credit revaluation surplus. Well, now I need a debit, and the question is, what do I debit? Well, to figure that out, we go back to our T accounts, and there's a specific order that we do this in. If you have any accumulated impairment losses, you get rid of them first until that account goes to zero. Well, in this case, we're already at zero, so I can't use it at all. Next step is to go to accumulated depreciation. And I would record as much as I could in accumulated depreciation until that goes to zero. In this case, I want to do an $80,000 adjustment. If I debit accumulated depreciation for $80,000, accumulated depreciation can handle that and still have a balance. It can't go to a debit, basically is what we're saying. So it can go all the way to zero. I could record a $200,000 debit, but no more than that. If for some reason you go beyond even the accumulated depreciation, then the last step is to actually change the PP&E account. And you can only do that one if you have no choice. You've used up all the accumulated impairment losses and all of the accumulated impairment or depreciation, then you do get to change that PP&E account. So in this case, we've got plenty of leeway in our accumulated depreciation to record this $80,000. So let's go back and finish this journal entry. Accumulated depreciation to record the change in fair value. That's a very bad in, isn't it? There, that's beautiful. So let's get our T accounts up to date, and then we'll move on to step four, which is to do depreciation expense. So let's see, we credited revaluation surplus. That gives us a new ending balance here. We debited accumulated depreciation. So 200,000 minus 80 gives us a new credit balance of 120, except, oh, I can't record that yet because I still have depreciation expense to record. So I'll leave that 80 there, but I can't get an ending balance yet. Still got to do that depreciation expense entry, and that's where we're going next. So step number four is depreciation expense. So debit depreciation expense, credit accumulated depreciation. This is an adjusting entry for depreciation. And I'm going to show you the formal equation, and then I'm going to show you the shortcut. The formal equation is the property, plant, and equipment, or historical cost, minus any accumulated depreciation, minus any accumulated impairment losses, and then you subtract the salvage value and divide by the estimated useful life. All right, that's the formal way. There is a shortcut, though. I just did this. I readjusted those accounts so that they would equal the fair value. So I don't really need to go through this process again because I've already done it. I did it in order to make this journal entry up here. So I can change this to be the fair value minus the salvage value divided by the number of years if we're doing straight line. And we don't have to do straight line. We're doing straight line, so we don't have to worry about that too. So for our example, we have 880,000 minus zero divided by 8. Now that we've got that number, let's put it into our journal entry. And now I can finish off my T accounts because I was missing this accumulated depreciation number. So we'll go back, and we've now credited accumulated depreciation for 110. So 200 plus 110 minus 80 gives me an ending balance for the year of $230,000. And that's my first year under the revaluation method. A lot going on, isn't there, with this revaluation method? I think we probably need to look at another couple of years so that we're really comfortable with this. And that's where we're headed next time, is years 2 and 3. I'll see you then.